does in terms of being able to capture this on his live stream and share it gives this conversation perpetuity throughout our community that will ensure anybody that you know who has interest in this conversation will be able to reference tonight. So this is not an hour conversation. This is not an hour dialogue. This really is the beginning, what I hope, of a long game shift in the culture of the way we do business in this city. The way we elect our officials, the way that we highlight issues around transparency and financial accountability, and also have a broader conversation around who is included in our community and through our democratic process and who is not. So all very exciting topics. I was interviewed or asked questions earlier by the esteemed Mr. Nolan about what my personal views are. And I can tell you I do have my personal views. They are fairly strong, as demonstrated here tonight, in terms of changes that I think we can make in this city to help close that democratic deficit. But that's not what I am here to do tonight. I am simply here extending my privilege in public office to utilize this civic space to have a civic discourse on our electoral reform. And I also have the privilege of having a fantastic Rolodex that really has preeminent, expert, knowledgeable, passionate advocates on this topic. So my role is simply to facilitate a conversation in this city, bring in the smartest people I know, people who are way smarter than I am, to be able to really lay out what we have here as a potential opportunity for our democracy. And so I really appreciate the fact that you've taken time to come here. I would also like to acknowledge and introduce Malcolm and Kelly, who are in attendance last. They're from Fair Vote Canada Hamilton chapter. If we can please give them a round of applause. Yeah,
over here. Thank you, Matthew. So just to give folks a little introduction, our chapter is a local one for what's known as Fair Vote Canada. It's a Canada-wide citizen group which is advocating what's known as proportional representation, or also we would call it PR for now. So all across Canada, almost all of our elections for public office happen with what's known as first past the post system. And anybody here know what that means? Yeah, so it simply means you got more votes than anybody else. It doesn't mean you got a majority of votes. All it means is you had a plurality of votes. And plurality means you got more votes than someone else. And it could be just one vote more. So that might have worked back in the early days when they started using it 800 years ago, when you maybe had two people running for office. But now we have multiple parties, multiple people representing different platforms. And Canadians have all kinds of values that they embody that are important to them. You know, there's for some the economy, for some it's security, for some it's the environment, for some it's social security or social justice. We keep having an electoral system that doesn't allow us to have a real representation of who we elected. Why do I say that? It's because at least 40% of the votes in every election across Canada, the ballots essentially are thrown away. We vote for people that, at least many of us vote for people that just end up not being in office to represent us. So if you want to find out more, first of all, I brought some tabloids. This breaks down in all kinds of great little statistics and little stories about how your vote may or may not count. We can, of course, tell you more just in conversation, and we're hoping to do a presentation in a couple of weeks. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. And I think it's worth noting that for the first time in a long time, we have two major political parties talking about PR in a federal election as part of their platforms. We're in a federal election, so I think it's very timely that Malcolm and Fair Vote have the opportunity to share with you what that might mean on our federal landscape. But I'm super excited for this. I got to tell you, I started a process a few years back where I was heading into Toronto to learn about the elections processes and how to manage campaigns and all that stuff. And I had the privilege, I don't know if it was through Samara or if it was through Maytree or Broadbent, one of those groups, one of those progressive lefty groups had a fantastic demonstration in a keynote in Dave Meslin. And there's somebody that I've been following online for quite some time. And for those of you, most of you probably have already heard of him, but for those of you that haven't, Dave is the founder of Ranked Ballot Initiative Toronto. It's called Rabbit. And he's the co-founder of Unlock Democracy Canada. His 2010 TED Talk, entitled The Antidote to Apathy, has over 1.4 million views. His Fourth Wall Project explored 36 proposals to make local democracy more accessible and participatory. Currently, Dave is crowdsourcing 100 remedies for a broken democracy. The result of this project will be published by Penguin Canada in 2017. And so, if you look at the history, I'm going to say, I'll even probably go out on a limb and say it, if you look at the history of this current Municipal Act review, if you were to trace it back to one person, if that was at all possible, or one movement, I would give credit to, from my own political observation, the work of Dave Meslin and countless volunteers in Toronto to put forward this opportunity to hopefully have that city never see another Rob Ford again. And it's without further ado that I call to the microphone Dave Meslin for his presentation on ranked balloting. Thank you very much, Dave.
I have to stand here the whole time, kind of. Do you need to be using a mic for the audio feed? Okay, because I like to walk around. Hey, Kelsey. Usually I would say make sure you turn your phones off, but whoever has the jungle thing, leave that on. That was awesome. So it's okay. So I'll be here. I'll stay here. I'm going to stay here. If anyone wants to come up, by the way, there's 15 council seats open. I mean it. Come on down. You feel so far away. Any volunteers? Billiana wants to come down. There we go. Step right up. Malcolm's coming down. There we go. Thank you. I'm lonely down here. It's me and Matthew. So I really want to thank Matthew for organizing this. Look at it. Yeah, it's creating a ripple effect. There's still four more on this side. This might be your only chance to sit in these seats until 2018, in which case there's other ways to fill these seats. But hey, you're in Matthew's seat. Okay, that's good. Thank you. This is so much better. Hi, everyone. I'm Dave. It's a real honor to be here, and I really want to thank Matthew for organizing this whole series of town halls. Politically, we tend to get, not distracted because it's important, but we get disproportionately distracted by whatever issue is most urgently being discussed at City Hall, so whether it's a casino or an LRT or whatever, and it's really important to every now and then step back and say, wait a minute, what about the whole system? What about the whole process? Are we using the best process in this building to choose people and how they interact with each other once they're on council, how we interact with them in between elections? So thank you for offering this opportunity. I think our system's broken. I think the levels of cynicism and apathy that exist are not because people don't care, but because they sense that the system is broken. And it's actually a rational response to disengage from a system that isn't responding back to you. So the question isn't how do we make people care about politics, or how do we transform them from apathetic to caring people. The question is, what is it about the system that has turned them off? And how do we dismantle those barriers to get people to release their inner activist, which I think everyone has? And the voting system is a big part of that. So Matthew framed this in his Facebook event with this thing, the 100 remedies for a broken democracy. You all have a card on your chairs, perhaps, about it. It's a crowdsourcing project, not a crowdfunding project. I'm not asking for your money. I'm asking for your ideas. I need 100 ways to fix democracy. It's a website where anyone can go on, log in, and put up your own ideas. I think for tonight, though, I want to really focus on the voting reform stuff. Does that make sense? We can open the door later to other stuff, but there's a real unique opportunity in Ontario right now, like absolutely historic opportunity to change our voting systems municipally, which will hopefully ripple upwards to provincial and federal, where the distortions are even worse. I mean, it's criminal, I think, that we continue to live in a country where the outcome of our elections are the exact opposite often of what people actually asked for. I mean, to the point where you can ask yourself, why do we bother having elections? We spend a lot of time and money and effort. We're doing it this year, 2015 federal election. We could easily end up with a party, any party at this point, it's unclear, but a party winning even though most people don't want them. They could even win a majority government even if most people don't want them. In the last federal election, the vast majority of Canadians, actually the last one was closer. Two elections ago, 60% of Canadians voted against Stephen Harper. And he won the election. And then he won an election with a majority of the seats the next time, even though still a majority didn't vote for him. And just to be nonpartisan and to show that this isn't about the right or the left, it's wrong for Harper, it's wrong for Kathleen Wynne, and it's wrong for Rachel Notley. None of those people should have majority governments representing a province where a majority of the citizens didn't vote for them. I was invited to do a debate on the CBC a few months ago with Peter Mansbridge debating whether democracy is broken or not. And there's a line that I usually only use in front of high school students because I was worried it would be too radical to say in audiences like this, but I said it on live TV with Peter Mansbridge and he liked it, so I'm just gonna say it here now because you have to be careful with this stuff. If you start saying things like we don't live in a democracy, you sound crazy because in other countries you get shot for even trying to have a forum like this. So we do have to recognize how lucky we are to live in a place where we have freedom of expression and where we do have free elections, but we don't have free and fair elections if votes don't actually translate into what people ask for. So here's the line. In most countries in the Western democracy, almost any country in Western democracy, if a party takes power against the will of the majority, it's called a coup. And it's a bad thing. And it's illegal under the UN, and we send in planes sometimes and bomb people and this and that. And in Canada, we call it an election, and we publicly finance the whole thing. But essentially, that's what we do. I mean, we have these things called elections. The beautiful idea of an election is that every voice matters, and everyone expresses themselves through this process. And people like Matthew and others get up here and say, I'm going to run. Here's my platform. Here's my ideas. But it's really up to you. What do you think? And then we all waste our time going to these polling booths and then voting, knowing that the outcome might not look like anything that represent anything that we actually asked for. And this doesn't just happen federally, provincially, it happens municipally. And it's harder to track because we don't have the party systems to look at the disproportionate outcome. But the clearest example is that we have incumbents in Toronto, a whole bunch of them, who were rejected by a majority of their own constituents in 2014 election. So we went to the polls, more than 50% said, Ron Moser, not that I'm picking names here, but Ron Moser, we don't want you back. I think it was like 65% of his constituents didn't want him back, and he's back. That's crazy. It doesn't meet the dictionary definition of what democracy is, right? If a majority of a ward can't get rid of a councillor they don't want, why are we wasting our time? We could literally roll the dice in our provincial and federal elections and maybe end up with more accurate outcomes and save a lot of time and money. But a better option is to fix our voting system. And what was I actually going to say? That was just my intro rant. I was just trying to say thank you to Matthew for organizing this, and then I went on a tangent. 100 remedies, voting reform. So quick background for me. So I'm a big fan of proportional representation. I worked on the Speaker's Bureau of the Ontario referendum, which we had in 2007, for a system called mixed member proportional in Ontario. And a lot of you might be saying, what are you talking about? And that was the problem with the referendum. No one knew about it, and we didn't win it. And then I was the director of field organization in British Columbia for a referendum they had there in 2009 for a different proportional system called STV. Both beautiful systems. Do not get pulled into divisive groups that pit MMP against STV, because they're both awesome, they're different, but take what you can get when it comes to voting reform. And they're both really beautiful. I mean, when Malcolm and Kelly come back in a couple of weeks or whatever, they'll talk more in detail about those. I can answer some questions tonight if you want, but we're going to focus on municipal, where MMP at least isn't an option, but STV is. And sorry if I've confused you already. That's okay. That's what we're here for. We're gonna sort it all out. After those two referenda, both of which failed, less than 50% voted for the change, although, footnote, British Columbia has had two referenda on voting reform. to bring in proportional representation. The first one was in 2005. Should we abandon first past the post and switch to a system called single transferable vote, which was chosen by a nonpartisan citizens' assembly of randomly chosen citizens, male and female from every riding? It's a beautiful system, kind of like the way we have juries that are randomly chosen for court. The idea is that if we randomly choose people and get beyond the usual suspects like me or the politicians like Matthew, just normal people, get them into a room and say, what do you collectively think is best for us? But run them through a whole process of being educated on the pros and cons of all the different options and then going through a facilitated deliberative process. They chose STV and then it went to a referendum. 58% of British Columbians voted yes. 58. That's huge. That's almost twice as much as Wynne Harper or Notley got in their landslide victories where like 35% voted for them, right? 58% want to change the system, but they had set the threshold for 60. So we lost our referendum while, I don't know who it was at the time, if it was before Clark, it was who won the BC election in 09? Anyone? Anyway, someone. Someone won it with, let's say, 35, 40%, and we lost our referendum with 58. Anyways, that was 05. We redid the referendum in 09, and sadly, we did terribly for a variety of reasons, which I can get into later if you're interested, but it doesn't really matter now. The point is, I think that the real opportunity to make change happen is actually municipal. And I got thinking about that by realizing that we weren't winning it provincially, but also taking a step back and realizing how many social movements start in rooms like this. Big federal changes that you hear about, whether it's gay marriage or whether it's banning shark fin or whatever, every massive important social change movement, like banning shark fins, one of the most important movements of our time. Let's try gay marriage. That one's bigger. It actually started with city halls, right? I mean, things start locally, and then they trickle up. Federal governments don't take risks on big new ideas. They wait. These are like the laboratories of change, right? And the smaller the city, the better. So you're like, I don't know where you'd be on the spectrum. You're in the top 10 for Ontario? What size, what's the one, what are we doing? What are we, 10, 15? Are we not 8th biggest? The 10th biggest? 6th biggest in Ontario. So that's pretty big. So you might not even be the first. I actually think this is going to happen in some tiny village in the middle of nowhere, and then we're all going to follow along later. But maybe it'll happen in 2018. But my point is that I think the best opportunities to change reform isn't to put all of our eggs in the federal basket, although it's great that Fair Vote and others are have a lot of optimistic hopes pegged on Mulcair and Trudeau, both of which are promoting different systems. Only the NDP and the Greens are committed to PR, but the Liberals are open to looking at it now, which is great. But to be honest, I think the changes will happen locally, in city halls, but also think of how many elections we participate in our lives throughout the year. Condo boards, campus elections, student councils, tenant associations, residents associations. I don't know what else you're involved with, but every nonprofit has a board with an AGM. So why don't we start getting those groups as well? So we have a thing called the Campus Democracy Project where we're trying to get student councils to change their system. I think this is where the magic will happen, and from there it'll be unstoppable and it'll trickle up. So I started this thing called RABBIT in Toronto, the Ranked Ballot Initiative of Toronto. I thought that the cell phone companies seemed to be very successful at using furry animals to sell mobile plans on billboards, so I wanted to get in on that. So we have a cute rabbit logo, which we use for our buttons and t-shirts, and it's gone very well. Essentially what we're proposing is a simple idea of using a ranked ballot where you rank your choices 1, 2, 3. And I'm going to run through it slowly to explain how it works and why it's better and how the current system is broken. And I'm going to do that using a quilt, because how else would you do it? I need 2 volunteers.
And
so, we're having an election, and the big issue of the day is, do we want a mayor with earrings or not? That's a tough call.
Kimberly Tuckall. Can you go to the microphone for a minute and tell the audience why you want a mayoral earrings? You got 20-second campaign. No campaign financing.
It takes a lot of forethought.
Don't look at me. These are your voters. Oh. I'm just one guy. I don't even live here.
You asked the question. Okay, it puts a lot of thought into picking the earrings to match the outfit, and I'll put the same thought into the decisions that I make. So that would be the worst thing ever.
You don't want to marry with earrings. Tell them why.
I think there are more important issues to tackle in our government. And we don't want a mayor who wastes time checking out their earrings. We want to tackle the issues head on. So vote no earrings.
And that's, obviously, I'm in the no earring camp. I think it slows you down.
Well, they're great fishing lures. I'll never go wrong.
I'm a pacifist and you just lost the vote. Unless you're throwing them back in. So, let's just quick show of hands. Earrings? Okay, no earrings? I'd say it's 60% no earrings. It was close, but if you could just hold that up really proudly. So, and then if you could hold that up and show it to everyone. So we have 60 and 40, right? So there you go. So 60% vote for no earrings, 40% for you. Who's the winner now? Okay. Well, that actually works out just fine. What's the problem? Oh, the problem is that there's only two candidates. So the funny thing about first past the post, there's two funny things about first past the post. The first one is that there's no post to pass. what we're proposing is actually first past the post, where there's a threshold that you have to pass. It's a horse racing term, right? That there's a post, and the first horse that gets past it wins. But, I mean, there isn't one in our system. We're going to show that in a second. I mean, the biggest flaw of first past the post is that there isn't a post. Anyways. So, that worked out great. Keep holding those up with pride. So, here's the thing. So now, Matthew, are you into politics? Do you want to run?
I might be political.
Do you think that mayor should have earrings? Or, like, what's your position on this whole earring thing?
I am pro-choice. I just flip-flop as a official politician.
You can't do that.
Oh yeah, no, I really hate earrings.
Why? Tell them.
Well, again, the problem is that we're focused on the material, you know, the upper class, the 1% are the only folks who can afford earrings. Quite frankly, I think that they're a little bit gaudy.
Yeah, that's elitist. Very elitist. Okay, so this is where it breaks down. As soon as you introduce a third candidate, first past the post becomes literally useless. It's no longer an electoral system at all. It's an exercise of randomization of who splits the vote the most. It has nothing to do with what people think or what people's platforms are. Because 60% of you want a mayor without earrings, but you're going to have to rip that in half now and give some of that to Matthew, because you still only got 60% to work with. So now we've got, you figured that out. Excellent. So hold those up. So three candidates, same positions, same issue, same topic, same big divisive hot topic of the day, earrings. Same electorate, 60 and 40. Who's the winner now?
Earrings.
Woo! Right. Who's the winner? So wait a minute. This is a problem. We now have a mayor with earrings, even though 60% of the city didn't want a mayor with earrings. So why don't we just have an election? Again, you could roll the dice, and 50% on this issue, you'd actually have, you know, a chance of getting it right. You could have saved a lot of money and time. And that's just three people. What if, have you ever had four people run for council? Ever had five? I think you had up to 10 or more run in some of the open seats. So let's see what happens. So let me, let's see, how do I do this? There's a few different angles I want to go. What I want to actually do is rewind this, which means, but in like slow-mo. So you attach that back together, and then Matthew's going to walk back towards your seat backwards, but not all the way, just like, let's say halfway. Going, hold that up with pride, because you're still winning now. Frown on you, because you're losing. Okay, stop. So the bigger problem about first, thank you, that was amazing. Don't stay there. The bigger problem about first past the post isn't just that the math is unfair, and that we can fix it. The bigger problem is what's going to happen when we've got these two candidates in, and then rumors start circulating amongst the no earrings contingent of the city that Matthew's thinking of running. So start walking towards there. What are the no earring people going to say to Matthew?
Split the vote.
What? Can you turn your microphone? You have a button?
Yeah, press the button.
Which button?
Don't split the vote.
What does that mean? What should he do to not split the vote?
Not run.
But this is a democracy. We live in Canada. He wants to run. He has an opinion. He's enthusiastic. He's passionate. You agree with him.
But then he won't get the no hearings.
So his contribution to democracy should be not running. Okay. And that is exactly what happens. This happens for mayor races. It happens for council races. It happens behind closed doors. It happens invisibly. I don't know to what degree it happens here because I don't know what your dynamics are. I can tell you in Toronto it happens all the time. I have friends who it's happened to, and I'm going to share a quick story about that in a second. And let me say this too: more often than not, the person who's pushed out is younger. More often than not, a woman, and more often than not, a person of color. Because the person who's the front runner, regardless of whether they came in first, whether they were in first, it's actually like, well, who can beat her? Who's the more likely person to beat them? And it's often the son of another politician. I mean, it's unbelievable that hundreds of years after we overthrew this idea of hereditary monarchy, well, I mean, it's Trudeau, but it's not just Trudeau, it's the Fords. Mike Layton is now third generation, it's Josh Cole. I mean, we have our Kennedys and Bushes and Clintons right here in Canada. And it's crazy. And when we try to figure out who's the best person to beat someone, it's often a white male, Adam Vaughan. His dad was a counselor and a journalist, and then Adam became a journalist and then ran. And I had a friend who was in that war already, young female Chinese, who was told that she was, oh sorry, that was the next time. I can't even remember. This was Karen's son. She was told that she was splitting the vote once. That was with Layton? Yeah, that was with Mike. So she was splitting the vote for Mike. So this happens every time. And I'll tell you another story, but I'll finish with you guys. You're not like standing up here for an hour. The point is, people are told not to run, and nothing is more toxic to a political culture than you being told not to run this election, or the Greens being told that they're ruining it in every riding, or the NDP being told up until this year that they're ruining it for the Liberals, now maybe the Liberals are ruining it for them. I don't know, there's always someone who's Ralph Nader elected Bush, right? I mean, it's so terrible for us to accuse the most passionate people who are bringing new voices into the political world that they're the ones ruining it. And that the best thing they can do is to shut up and go home and take their name off the ballot. So the ranked ballot system, which I'll explain in a minute, allows you to run. But let's say, as you're walking here, you and others tell you not to run, and you say, well, screw you, I'm running anyways. So now what happens? You've got two candidates without earrings. Now you get into strategic voting. Well, I really like Matt, but I think you have a better chance of winning, so I should vote for you. Oh, wait, a new poll's come in. It's looking closer now. Maybe you have a better chance. I like you better. And suddenly, elections become about these calculations, not of who you want, but who's most likely to beat the person you hate the most, which it doesn't have to be like that with any of the systems we're talking about, MNP, STV, or ranked ballots in single-member districts. So first of all, you'll be allowed to run. Second of all, you can vote with your heart. And most importantly, you end up with the proper outcome, which is what the majority wants. But there's another good thing that happens. So rip it apart again. So they're all in the race now. So when you're running, actually, let me explain how the runoff is. How many people don't know what a ranked ballot is, how it works, and what a runoff is, and the 50% threshold? Okay, great, that's all we need. There's others too that are being shy. Thank you. So if you're all being shy, I wouldn't know. So the system is very simple. Every party in Canada uses this to elect their own leaders. And the idea is that if a majority of the people don't want you, you shouldn't win. Which kind of sounds crazy for us to even have to say that, but we do, because our current system doesn't do that. So you need to reach a post, which is 50%, and the first to get past the post wins, okay? 50% threshold. This is for single member districts. I can explain after an even better way of doing it. But with a single member district, let's just use mayor, for example, which is what we're doing. So if you want to be mayor of a city, at least 50% should want you. So what do we do here? 35, 25, 40. So no one's hit the magical threshold of 50. What would a party do? You've watched party leadership races on TV. What happens? Say it louder.
Drop the lowest.
Drop the lowest. So who's the lowest here? Matthew, sorry buddy. Wait, don't take the votes with you. You leave. So now, essentially, there's a few ways to do it. The way the political parties used to do it is say, okay, everyone, first round is in. 25, 35, 40, candidate Green is out. Thanks for running. And then your votes, essentially in the second round, what we say is, okay, everyone, we're going to vote again. Sorry, dude, you're amazing, but you weren't amazing enough. It's democracy. People get hurt. Their hearts get crushed. So now we say, okay, everyone, come back. Only two candidates left now. We're going to vote again. And where are these going to go? You might get some of them. I mean, it's possible, right? Because maybe some of those people hate facial hair more than they hate earrings. And they're like, oh, okay, I'll go with the earrings because of the beard. But you'll get most of them. Oh, you have 9% now. You just lost. Okay, so it goes back to 60. The idea is, in a runoff, it's as simple as that. If no one wins the majority, you drop the candidate with the least, and you can do this over and over and over again until someone reaches 50%. And let's make this even a little more fun.
So the filter was right, just had it upside down.
You're gonna win either way. Let's get rid of these, actually, just in time. Let's have another one. So I'm gonna actually hold this one. This will be fun. So, but both of you stay here. So now, sorry about the audio, I gotta walk away sometimes.
This yeah, no problem. I
have to watch this online. Sorry, everyone. Just watch. I'll enunciate so you can read my lips.
I have a hot mic.
Move just away from the microphone.
I have a hot mic, so they get it. It's just not very clear because the room has a bit of an echo. But don't worry. Don't let it interfere with the great performance.
I won't. Nothing will get in my way. And nothing's gonna get in the way of me winning the next election. So I'm the mayor now. I'm Mayor Meslin. And I'm doing a terrible job, absolutely terrible job. No one likes me anymore. I've broken laws. I drive in the HOV lane. And people are just thinking, yeah, that's not right, that's not fair, and I'm setting a bad example. So my popularity has dropped to 20%. This is pretty bad, it's pretty low. So I'm in trouble, which sucks, because I want to keep the job and my pension. But that's okay, because this is first past the post. So this is what happens. Julie's going to run against me. Just hold it up. This is creative 80, right? Did I get that right? Yeah. It's a squiggle. It's a weird squiggle. That's what happens when you ask artists to make your quilts. So this is what will happen if one person runs against me. And again, first past the post works amazingly in a two-person race. So I need three more volunteers. Three of you can just walk up here for a second. So if one person runs against me, I'm in trouble. And here's where first past the post is so annoying. The more engaged the population is, the less chance they have of having an impact collectively. So if 80% want to get rid of me, but they're all so lazy that only June runs, I lose. But if an environmental group runs someone, and a queer group, and a community gardening group, and a knitting group, all run against me. Can you wrap that up now? I might need one more. Quick, come up. So now you've got 80% who want change, but some of them want you. You're not sure. Hold up your numbers with pride. 19%. Oh, sorry. We had enough. That's okay. How embarrassing. 12, 14, 17, 18, 19, 20. This adds up to 100, my friends. And I'm the winner. This happens in Toronto. We have people win with as low as 17%. I think your lowest was around 30 or something. But it can get as low as this. And of course, if this can be infinitely expanded. You can win an election with 2% of the vote. But this is crazy. So what happened here is, who's got the lowest? You are the lowest. Julie is the lowest. So we would have another round, and this 12 would go somewhere else. What a ranked ballot does is, instead of saying, okay, Julie's out, everyone vote again, we only have 5 candidates left, where do you want to go, Julie supporters? On a ranked ballot, you've already listed your first, second, and third choice. So whoever wanted you to be mayor would have put Julie first, and maybe put you second, or someone would have put you second. It's called an instant runoff. The votes get retabulated right away. And what the advantages are is that all of you are allowed to run. None of you are being accused of hurting June's chance of beating me. In fact, she ended up being the first one out, right? And I don't know who's going to win in the end. What happens here is, you don't necessarily win because you have the highest second place member with 19. The person who wins, the person who attracts the most second and third choices, essentially you become a consensus candidate. But the best part is, when you're campaigning against each other, under the current system, there's an incentive to go negative. My vote can only go up if your vote goes down. I can't gain a single vote unless I steal it from you. So I'm going to dig up dirt or try and think of ways to somehow damage your credibility, right? You never went to university. Your watch is 10 minutes off, whatever. You drove an HOV lane. I don't know, whatever it is. You're too young. You're not ready, right? I mean, most of the ads we're seeing now for the federal election aren't about why Mulcair, Trudeau, or Harper are good. It's why someone else is bad. And that works in the first past the post. But think about it. In a runoff, whoever, you know who's going to win? The person who hasn't alienated their opponent's supporters. So you still want to differentiate yourself as a candidate. You don't want to be too nice because you have to explain why you're the best. But instead of saying, these guys are morons, you got to vote for me because they're garbage and they're not ready, you'll say things like, well, that's a very good policy you have on incineration, but mine's a little different, and here's why. And here's why my position will be better for this city, for the jobs and the economy, and our children and our children's children. But good job for having a constructive idea. It becomes respectful, and it becomes more intelligent, and it becomes about the ideas instead of the negativity. So round of applause for all of our... Those would have, of course, added back up to 80. I'll spare you the putting five pieces back together with Velcro. So that's essentially how it works in a single member district. So the problem with that is that it's still a majoritarian system. The better system, which Faribault advocates for provincially and federally, although you don't have to do it this way.
There's different ways to get proportional outcomes, but let's just take that first example with the earrings and no earrings. So 60% wanted, what was it again? No earrings? Right. So that's nice. The problem is if every ward in Hamilton was voting that way, then you'd end up with a council with the ranked ballot with 100% no earrings. You'd have no earrings on council, even though 40% of the city still wanted it. The voice wouldn't be represented here. So at least you've brought it to a majority system where you don't get a fake majority against the will of what people want, but it's not a proportional system. There's different ways to do proportional systems federally and provincially. The two models are MMP and STV, but MMP requires parties, so I won't even go there now, but you'll hear all about it perhaps because it's the model that the NDP has chosen federally and the model that our Citizens Assembly chose in Ontario. The system that works federally, and you could also do it municipally to different degrees, is called STV, a single transferable vote. And I won't go into it in details. Google it. Look up a video by CGP Gray. He's this really fun guy who makes cute animations explaining how all these different voting systems work. But essentially, you have multi-member districts. Instead of having one councillor, you could have two, three, four, or five. And the higher the number goes, the more proportionate the outcome is. So to go back to that example of 60-40, let's say you took Vancouver's fully at large, actually. Let's say you took Hamilton's city council. You got 15 councillors now. You go to five wards. Three seats each. Out of those three, using the ranked ballot on STV, no earrings will win two, and earrings will win one. So the majority gets their way, but that earring voice is still represented. You've created a possibility for an element of proportionality by going to a multi-member district. And one way you could do that in Hamilton is to either create five wards of three each, or three wards of five each, or there's different hybrid models, and I know that at least one person in Faribault is looking at this, Marvin. It's a great idea, and it's already being done in Ontario, where you keep your wards, but have a few at-large seats on top of that. So you could go down to 10 wards, make them a little bigger, and then have five people who are at-large, which gives you two benefits. One is that they represent the city citywide, instead of just one neighborhood. But number two, you can create an element of proportionality within those five, as low as 20%, right? I want to tell you a quick story of just how real this is. So I ran a really fun project in 2006 called City Idol in Toronto. And it was based on this idea that politics could look and feel differently, and that there's other people who would step up to the plate if the system felt more inviting and inclusive, and that it's kind of an insider game right now, especially in Toronto. And so I had this crazy idea. Like American Idol, I would invite people onto a stage to compete in front of a live audience. But instead of competing with their voices and their songs to show that they're the best rock star, they would come to the stage with their ideas of how to make the city better in front of a live audience, that they show that they have what it takes to be a city councilor. And then the audience would vote for their favorites. And then we had a semifinal and a final. We did a bunch of exercises on stage. They had to do a media scrum to show that they're good on their toes, in addition to writing a good speech. And in American Idol, the winner gets a record deal. In City Idol, the winner gets an election campaign. You're gonna have no experience. I don't care if you're right wing, left wing, what age you are. If you can convince the crowd that you've got what it takes to make the city better, we will run a campaign for you. We'll fundraise for you. We'll give you lawn signs. We'll give you a website, media training, everything. And we had four winners from different parts of the city, Etobicoke, North York, Scarborough, and downtown. And it was a very idealistic project, and a lot of people told me I was crazy and wasting my time. But I knew that I felt it would create something different. And one thing I wanted to show was that city council doesn't have to be as white and male dominated as it is. Toronto, we pride ourselves on being one of the most diverse cities in the world. But then you go into council and it's like, well, where is that diversity? Why does it not exist on our, you know, legislative body that represents us? So I wanted to recruit candidates from underrepresented communities and give them a voice and a chance to run. And it was amazing. The candidates were very diverse, really smart, really fun. 600 people showed up to our opening night. It was actually the largest event of the entire election. Because that was Miller's second run. So there wasn't a big contested mayor race. It was kind of a sleepy election, and we were kind of the biggest thing happening in a way. And the media was all over it, too. And what happened was, four people won. Amarjeet Chabra, Sikh female, labor activist, she won our final in Scarborough. Bahar Amin Vaziri, Iranian female, won our North York final. Desmond Cole, who's been in the media a lot recently for his amazing work on carding, he was our winner in 2006 for the downtown. And Arthur Roshak was our winner in Etobicoke. And I was like, this is great. Like, that's Toronto, who's very diverse. One white guy out of four, not bad. And they ran campaigns, we set up websites for them, we did fundraising, and then what happened is we organized an event at City Hall where they gave their $100 to sign up to run. And we invited the media, and it was just like so empowering for them and for me to see that this idea I had was coming to fruition. And then Amarjeet gets a phone call from her own allies, from the equivalent of the role you played a minute ago. Amarjeet, we love you, you're great, but you can't run in Ward 44. This is where she chose to run. I told them to run wherever you want. This was a new Democrat from City Hall. She's a labor activist. New Democrat staffer at City Hall said, Amarjeet, you can't run in 44. You're gonna split the vote. There's a liberal incumbent who isn't as left-wing as we'd like, but she's mostly voting with Miller, so you know we're happy with her, and she's being challenged by a conservative, and you're gonna ruin it. And I was devastated. She was devastated. She did drop out of that race. She ran in a different ward where she had no roots. And right off, this light just went off in my head, 2006. And I was like, wait a minute. Like, I've been watching leadership races for years, and that's not the way it's supposed to work. So I started researching it and Googling it and finding out that American cities don't do it the way we do it. They've all got some form of mechanism to ensure that that doesn't happen, either through primaries or through a second round runoff 2 weeks later where you go to your top two, or a ranked ballot. So Minneapolis is using a ranked ballot. San Francisco is using a ranked ballot. And I went to those cities. I went to San Francisco, I went to Minneapolis, I met with the activists, I met with voters. I went to Minneapolis for an entire election and watched the whole thing unfold, interviewed voters, asked them if they found the ballot confusing, if they found it had an impact on campaigns treating each other in a more positive manner. Minneapolis was amazing. This was 2 years ago I went. They elected a female mayor, 50% female counselor, their first Somali counselor ever, their first Latina counselor ever, and their first Hmong counselor ever, their second time using ranked ballots. So absolutely transformative. And so many people told me that they felt the candidates were treating each other in a more fair way. Desmond Cole was also asked to drop out of his race. And he didn't, he stayed in. But he had so many people at the door say, Des, I think you're great. And I actually think you're winning the debates, because if any of you heard him speak, like, he's just, incredibly eloquent and inspiring in a frightening way. And but it wasn't his race. There was a tight race between Helen Kennedy and Adam Vaughn. Adam Vaughn, the son of a former counselor, and Helen Kennedy, the executive assistant of a former counselor, Olivia Chow. Both total insiders in their own ways. Great people. They're both fantastic people, but coming from the inside of the system. And people told Desmond he didn't have a chance. They weren't going to waste their vote. So one of the good things about a ranked ballot is he could have said, well, put me first. And then, you know, if enough people do that, I might win. If I drop off, your second vote will kick in, and you can still choose Adam or Helen. So he would have actually had a shot at least, not just winning, but at least knowing how much support he had. People would have been more comfortable giving him money or putting up a lawn sign. So strategic voting doesn't just play out in votes. If you're a Green Party supporter, but you're worried about, let's say, Harper winning, you don't just vote strategically. You're also not going to put up a green sign or give the Greens money, because you're just helping to split the whatever, the anti-Harper. And again, this isn't a left-wing thing. We're actually very proud of the Rabbit campaign in Toronto being supported by folks on the right, the left, and everything in between. And I'm completely nonpartisan. In fact, I spent the last year working for a conservative MP, Michael Chong, on a bill called the Reform Act, which we just won 2 weeks ago, even though some people in the Senate were trying to kill it. Amazing. Yes. Michael Chong is amazing. He's an amazing guy. There's a few folks in politics, Matthew, Michael, Desmond one day, who are just, you're just instantly, you're like, they're in it for the right reasons, and they're not trying to beat the other team. There's way too much partisanship in politics where it's like, I'm on the good team, that's the bad team, we have to beat the bad team. And it's just about bringing good ideas forward, and I'll work with anyone from any party to bring good ideas forward, and that's what we've been doing in Toronto. So what happened is, the good news is, and why I'm here and how this relates back to you, and what the province is doing now is, I organized this campaign, Rabbit, and I'm gonna have a sip of water. Water break, drink up. I'm a volunteer. All my friends are volunteers. The whole campaign is completely volunteer. And we started making a website and flyers and quilts and talking to journalists and talking to community leaders and academics and recruiting more volunteers and having events just like this. And slowly, from 2006 and 7 and 8 and 9 and 10, we finally reached a point where we thought we might be able to win a vote at council. And we got one city councilor to move a motion at committee, Councilor Paul Ainslie, who was a member of Rob Ford's executive, again, working with whoever's in power, because movement organizing isn't just about trying to make sure that your guy wins the next election. It's about building up so much support for your movement that it actually doesn't matter who's in power, because politicians will bow to public pressure, even if they don't agree with it. So we built up this campaign, we moved a motion, staff wrote a report. And what the report said is, well, you're not allowed to use ranked ballots. If you want to use ranked ballots in Ontario, you actually need to change the Municipal Elections Act. So council needs to move a motion asking the province to change the Municipal Elections Act. So a motion went forward for that. We won that vote 26-15. And just to give you a context of how historic this is and the role you can play here, Canada is one of the only countries, if not the only country, I don't know of another country, that is currently using first past the post for every election at all three levels of government. Because America doesn't, England doesn't, France doesn't, Australia doesn't, and all other European countries are using some form of PR. So what we're talking about here is actually introducing the first non-first past the post elections anywhere in Canada in our lifetime. And it's happening right now. Because the province said, okay, council's moved this motion. Actually, the government officially said nothing. Two MPPs, Mitzi Hunter, who's awesome, Liberal MPP, Scarborough Guildwood, and Jonah Shine, who was my MPP at the time, NDP Davenport, they brought forward private members' bills. And Mitzi's bill made it through second reading, went to committee. This was a bill to give the city of Toronto, only Toronto, permission to use ranked ballots. And at the time, I felt it was sad that the government fell, an election was called, and we lost our bill. But it turns out, and this is why I'm here tonight, that it was for the best. Because after the government fell and the election was called, we started mobilizing our thousands of supporters to ask the Liberals, Conservatives, and New Democrats, if you're elected, what are you going to do for ranked ballots? And the NDP said, we will let Toronto do it if we're elected. And the Liberals said, if we're elected, we will let any city in Ontario use ranked ballots. There's 444 municipalities. And she won, as far as I know. She won a majority, a fake majority, but a majority nonetheless. And then she sent out a series of mandate letters, Kathleen Wynne, and her mandate letter to her Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing, Ted McMeekin, said, one of the things I want you to do is to let every city in Ontario use ranked ballots in time for the 2018 election. The province is currently holding consultations on that. They're committed to doing it. It will be happening. Legislation is coming in the fall. It'll be final, it'll reach final reading by the spring, I think. And at that point, it's 444 green lights across Ontario. Every city from Wawa to Windsor to Whitby and Hamilton, you can use it. And it'll be up to councillors like Matthew to be the champions on the inside, but it won't happen without champions on the outside. So what I've been doing is I started this group called 123 Ontario. Our website is 123ontario.ca. And I'm setting up a network of ranked ballot campaigns across Ontario, both for single member districts, where the 50% threshold kicks in, and for multi-member districts, where it's a proportional outcome. And I'm leaving that up to each local city to decide what they think is practical and achievable. The proportional system is a better system because the proportional outcome is the holy grail of any, for any election advocate. In Toronto, it's not, I don't think it's practical. And that's for you to figure out here what's practical here in Hamilton. But we have a 123 London campaign. We have a 123 Guelph campaign. We have 123 Windsor. We have Ottawa 123. They didn't get 123 Ottawa because someone already had the URL. Let's see what we have. Guelph, London, Windsor, Whitby, Sudbury. And I feel like Hamilton's just this, it's nagging at me. We should have a Hamilton one. So I'm actually here to recruit. It's really fun. I won't say it's easier than you think, because it's actually a ton of work, but it's simpler than you think. It might be daunting to think, oh, I can't run a nonprofit campaign about changing the voting system in Ontario's sixth largest city, but you can, because I'm doing it, and like, who the hell am I? Like, no one hired me to do this. I never even went to university. Like, I'm not the executive director of anything. I just really believe in positive, constructive social change. And I believe that if you find other people who share that view and bring them together into a room just like this, and then come up with a name for your group, 123 Hamilton sounds catchy. And then you come up with a logo and a brand, and you hold a meeting, and you ask people, like, who knows how to do fundraising? Who knows how to do writing? Who's good at social media? Who knows how to do database management? Who knows how to do, what other skills do you need? Quilt making, right? Event organizing. You get those people in a room and you just do it. And it's tough work. It's the most rewarding thing you could ever do in your life to have legislation come in and be like, I did that. That happened because of me and my friends. I'm telling you, it's like, it's amazing. So I wanna start with, I wanna echo what Matthew said to thank you for being here, because you could have just been at home watching TV or in a park enjoying this beautiful weather. You came here, that's amazing. But it's not enough. We need leaders to make this happen in Hamilton. So some of you don't have the time to be leaders, that's okay too. But you should at least leave here today by giving, I guess for now it's Matthew. At some point it'll be campaign coordinator Julie or Kelsey or I don't know all your names, Narinder. Someone's gonna step up. Maybe it'll be three people, maybe four, maybe five, maybe 10. It might just be one. There's a woman named Mita Williams who's running 123 Windsor on her own. It's just Mita. And she's doing great. She's in the news, and the media will flock to you. It's once you've created the brand and the space, they'll come to you and say, okay, what is this about? And you better have your answers ready, because they'll have tough questions for you, which is, again, hard, but totally fun. And we have a province-wide network that will help you with all that. We'll give you resources, we'll train you. So let me just take questions about this, about the provincial process, about ranked ballots, about the STV model, or questions about how to organize. If any of you want to take this on, what are your questions about how to make things happen? Because I have a lot of answers. And there's no right way to do it either. I'll just tell you what's worked for me. And please, if you could start by just saying your name, so I know your name, that'd be great. Oh, yeah, Matthew has something to say.
Yes, just quickly for way of process, because it is tagged into the audio.
Oh, yeah.
So if we have people asking their questions from the audience, it won't be picked up.
And I'll
so
repeat it.
We have a couple of different options. You can come down to this front row and chime in there, or you can come down and join Wilhelmina and I here at the mayor's podium and ask your question here. It's very important for me that, and for all of us, I think, for this movement and this conversation, that it is recorded and live streamed so that we can share it. And so it's very important that when people ask their questions, it goes on the record and the response.
But if you're feeling really lazy, we can repeat it too.
Okay, that's true. That is right? Also true. Yes.
It's your democratic choice to be lazy. Great. Up to you, absolutely. You can be the mayor. Well, I assume that's the mayor's seat. Unless he's into this. There's a big movement now for stand-up desks. Is this the mayor's stand-up desk?
Yes.
Cool.
Okay, so Raheem Aman, I just had a quick question. So you have to be nonpartisan to be affiliated with this? Because I'm affiliated with the Green Party of Canada.
No, absolutely not. The group has to be nonpartisan. So lots of people in our group are part of every party. It just means that as a movement, you can't, if you're as a spokesperson, you can't reveal your partisanship. So if you're doing interviews, for example. But also, it just means when you're explaining the benefits of it, you don't say, well, we can use this to get out the right-wingers or the left-wingers or whatever. Some people get involved with electoral reform specifically to get rid of a certain movement or a certain political stripe. I think it's a big problem. The electoral movement in Canada right now is heavily left-leaning. Huge problem. Because there's nothing left-wing about it. But because Harper right now is benefiting from it, it tends to be anti-Harper people, which is a problem. So what you ideally want to do now as a Green is find a liberal, a new democratic conservative. But this is municipal politics too, so everyone's nonpartisan municipally. But the main thing is that you don't want anyone to read your website or hear your interview and think, oh, it's a green thing or a liberal thing or a left-wing thing or an anarchist thing or whatever. You want to have a message that appeals to the broadest audience possible. But of course you'd be more than welcome to be a leader, and I hope you do. And I love the Greens, and I'm fighting really hard to get Elizabeth May included in the debates. You know, under a proportional system, the Greens would already have 15 to 30 seats. Think about that. I mean, 500,000 people voted for the Greens, and they were like, oh, we won one. Bye, guys. Awesome to see you. That's crazy. And then for any party to say, well, we don't know if they should be in the debate because they only have one seat, it's like, well, don't use first past the post to harm them even more. It's crazy. If they're going to set a threshold for debates, it should be based on popular vote, not based on seat count at all. Do you want to add in something? Or are you just waving?
I was waving.
Oh, yeah. So, answer is yes. And please do it. Okay. Awesome. And good luck this year to all parties. No.
Green?
No. That's very counterintuitive. Press the red button to start it. Green to stop.
The opposite of what it should be, right? So my name's Annette Van Olden-Barneveld. I'm wondering, what is the first contact point for starting this and getting the training that you have available? Would that be through you directly or 123 Ontario?
It's the same thing. I am 123 Ontario.
Nice.
just as you will be 123 Hamilton. So the neat thing about nonprofit groups is, this is off the record, that, you know, you can create this illusion that you're part of some large organization when you're not. And it's called fake it till you make it, and it's what all professional adults actually do in their jobs anyway, so it's totally ethical. You know, when I launched Rabbit, there was no Rabbit, and just like Mita she's in Windsor, a guy named Nick is doing it in Whitby, he just recruited a second person, Linda. It's okay for it just to be you, and then eventually 5, 6, I don't know, you're on board, some others. You have a website that makes it look like you have an office building with staff and then like HR people. I am one. You're looking at 123 Ontario. This is my office building and the HR department. The starting point is right now, and we'll go out for pizza after. First meeting of 123 Hamilton. I heard it's today at 8:39 at, where's the meeting? Who scheduled this meeting? 123 Hamilton. I don't know. I'll schedule right now. It's at what time is it now? Well, anyways, it's coming up. The first meeting of 123 Hamilton will congregate by that weird palm tree thing or something in the hallway as soon as this is done, and we're going to go get pizza and plan the local revolution. So how's that for an answer?
Perfect. Thank you.
Great. Okay. Who else wants to hit a red light to start something?
So, firstly, it's a pleasure to meet you.
Likewise.
You hold the distinction of being...
Oh, yeah. You got to see this guy.
You hold the distinction of being blamed by our city staff for this whole entire reform process. And I'm not kidding you. You were actually named as a Toronto activist.
What was that line that the Greek finance minister said a few days ago? He's like, I'm so proud that everyone hates me.
But I'm actually, what I'm interested in is that we have submissions on electoral reform.
Okay.
And I'm actually writing a column right now because yesterday we had an election audit compliance committee here. And it's the body that's supposed to oversee our elections. And I found really interesting, and instead of pointing at this committee, because I don't think the committee is the problem, I think it's the structure. The committee chair said he wasn't familiar with the Municipal Elections Act. And
okay.
I remember sitting there going, Mike, but that's like your entire function. That's what you exist for. So beyond ranked balloting, what are some of the issues that you're going to be addressing in your letter to the province on reform of the act?
Sure. I'll be honest. I've kind of got blinders on. I'm really focused on the ranked ballots because I think it's the biggest change. It's the lowest hanging fruit right now. And in Toronto, we've banned corporate and union donations, like our campaign finance reform. I don't think you've done that here. Do you have spending limits?
We have the provincially set spending limits.
So like in Vancouver, they don't have spending limits or campaign limits. Like they have nothing. They're like total Wild West. So everyone's got their own, like you got to figure out what's the next win for you. And maybe it's not ranked ballots. Maybe first you want to deal with campaign finance stuff. Like that's, I can't judge or inform that. In Toronto, the next big win is ranked ballots. The other ones that I think are interesting and definitely worth looking at, I think the issue around letting permanent residents, non-citizen permanent residents vote municipally is an amazing idea. And there's arguments against it that it erodes or dilutes citizenship, and I actually think it would have the opposite effect. It would bring people in and make them feel like they have a voice and have a sense of ownership over the system, and they're more likely to become citizens and participate provincially and federally. I fully support lowering the voting age to 16, but that's not about to happen at any level of government, but I think that's really winnable and really important. And it's not just because they're smart enough, it's because 18 is the worst age. If we're not going to do 16, we should actually do 25. People don't live at home when they're 18. A lot of them are off at campus, which means they're not at their voting booth, but also they might be, I don't know, they could be drinking, for example. They could be doing lots of things. That's not like the age to be like, hey, I've got your attention. Let's talk about democracy. It's like the last age I would ever choose. 16, you're in high school studying civics. Wouldn't that be amazing if the civics teacher, instead of saying, well, you're not old enough to vote yet, as a society, we don't really trust that you're intelligent enough yet to participate, but here's how civics works. Imagine if the intro was, hey, you're 16 now, it's time to vote. Do you want to learn about it? Right? So 16 would be huge. I don't know, there's lots of things. I think the way we run our debates is actually really problematic. Including municipal. I don't know what you do here if you have 12 people running for mayor. Like, who decides who goes to the debate? Or do you invite them all? In Toronto, there's like, it's the same as the federal scene, where they can just decide if Elizabeth is in or not. Municipally, they can just decide which candidates are in or not. I think that's a problem. Not that you should include everyone every time, but there needs to be a clear, transparent process for deciding. What else? There's a lot of talk about bringing political parties to the municipal system. I'm not a fan of that, although I think there are genuine benefits. I can see the pros and cons. I think the way our councils vote in a nonpartisan way is amazing. So we have 45 members of our council, 44 plus the mayor. And I was there yesterday watching. And what's amazing is that every vote is unpredictable, and it could be 45-0, 44-1, which is Rob Ford, 43-2, which is Rob Ford and Giorgio Mammoliti, all the way to 23-22, and anything you can imagine. And each time you're like, oh, wow, like I can't believe those two voted together. And you watch Queen's Park, and it's just so sad. And this is why I did the Reform Act in Ottawa. I mean, why do we hire these people and give them pensions and offices when they get up and they vote how they're told and they read speeches that someone else wrote for them? So I would hate to see our city councils voting as blocks with the right and the left just trying to like outsmart each other. And Vancouver has this. People say that it's not super partisan there, and there is a bit of independence for councillors. And the benefits are, though, that in between elections, we don't really have a much of a role. Like, Matthew's in, we love Matthew, great, go do it. What do? With political parties, there'd still be policy conventions and candidate nominations and electoral riding associations for each ward. So there are benefits, but there's no appetite for that in Toronto. I don't know if there is here. What else? I think we should get rid of the mayor. Not John Tory. And this is a total radical idea, but I actually think it's... I think it's a mistake that we still cling on to the idea of requiring a single person executive at the top. I think it's just like a biblical idea. It's like the last thing we've held on to of the idea of monarchy. We're going to elect them, but we still need to. Why does a council need a mayor? Why can't a council just be a council? We elect councillors, like a board. You know, board chair usually facilitates. They're not like, they don't necessarily have a higher executive power. You could elect 15 councillors, and they just make decisions based on a majority. And the reason that would be beneficial is because, at least in Toronto, I'm sure it's the same here, the mayoral election becomes the news, and you don't hear a lot about the council races. Does that happen here?
Yeah.
And that's a shame, because the mayor has one vote, and council here has 15, and in Toronto they have 44. No one knows who they are. We don't hear about them. All we hear about is John Tory and Olivia Chow, even though it's one person. So it's actually a huge distraction from local democracy. And the councillors are the most important people because, again, it's probably worse in Toronto, but like John Tory is not an accessible person anymore. I can't talk to John Tory, and I used to. Like, we used to hang out and go for lunch. His BlackBerry number doesn't work anymore because he's the mayor of Toronto. My conduit to democracy is my councillor, not the mayor. And we've almost removed the councillor from the political discussions because we focus on the mayor. Anyways, that was a bunch of ideas. This is why I'm writing a book. I'm looking for 100. I mean, those are all ideas in the book. I think the biggest problem is our education system, and that I think we teach apathy in schools instead of teaching people skills of political literacy and critical analysis.
Well, I can tell you, you just gave me a lot to think about, especially the idea of eliminating the mayor is something I never thought of. I've actually been thinking we need a strong mayor, but you've made a very compelling argument for the opposite. So I want to very much thank you for coming down to Hamilton today. I saw you enjoyed the go ride with your feet up on the seat, which, you know, everybody from Hamilton knows that's what you do midday.
I took my shoes off.
Yeah.
There was no dirt on the seat.
You should move to Hamilton because, you know, then you can enjoy that ride much more often. We'd love to have you. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Let me make a really important point here. The art isn't to figure out which changes you want or are the most interesting, because I just give you a whole bunch of really interesting ideas that if I could snap my fingers and change, I would. Don't try and get rid of your mayor. Don't try and change the voting system to 16, because it's not the thing that's winnable right now. The winnable thing right now is working with Fair Vote on the federal reforms to bring in proportional representation, pushing the Liberals a little further, supporting the NDP for their position and the Greens, and most importantly, if any of you are Conservatives, working within the Conservative Party to get them to support PR. It's actually a right-wing idea, in my opinion, to have a proportional voting system that allows the marketplace to be responsive to consumer demand, and that the bottom line of the parties is aligned with the demand and supply of votes. And then when 20% vote for a certain chocolate bar, that company gets the profit for that, right? So there's nothing left-wing about voting reform. It's an absolutely, totally aligned with all the ideas around innovation and creativity being benefiting from competition and a fair level playing field that allows startups to have influence on the big boxes, right? So anyways, I think it's a right-wing idea. Bring the Conservatives on board and municipally work on this ranked ballot thing. It's a really rare opportunity. We can do it. I don't know if Toronto will be the first. It might be 1-3 Hamilton, and the first meeting is happening tonight over pizza. And it doesn't have to be pizza. We can vote democratically here. We can go out for sushi, like whatever you want, and we will vote, and it will be a ranked ballot.
Ice cream.
Ice cream? There you go. Well, regardless of dinner, we're going out for ice cream after. Any other questions, or are people feeling tired? Because we could end the formal part of the night and just hang out and chat. How many people, just hands up, let's democratize this right now. I mean, it has been a long time. It's almost 8. Hands up if you want to end the formal part and those who want to go home can leave without feeling like awkward leaving in the middle of something, and the rest of us can chat, and how many want to keep going? So hands up for option number one, end the formal part of the night. Hands up. Someone else has to count. That's a lot. Hands up if you want to keep going as a formal event. Oh, that was easy. Great. So I would like to thank everyone. I'm going to pass it to Matthew to wrap up. I will hang out here. Both Matthew and I will both be here for at least the next 7 or 8 hours to talk further. But in terms of the official part of the night, based on this democratic participation, which is what I'm all about, we're going to wrap it up. Thanks for coming. Thank you so much, Matt, for inviting me. And I really look forward to working with volunteers in this room to set up 123 Hamilton.
So a couple of things. Wow, you've certainly come in here and you've given us a ton to think about. And as I mentioned earlier in the evening, this has never been for me about, you know, pushing my wishes in terms of what I want, where the direction I want to see this go. But it's a very compelling story to decrease the democratic deficit that we have in our process. I ran against 14 other candidates. And I also, I can share this with you, got the tap on the shoulder, you know, from the inside Social Democrats to say, maybe you don't want to run in this one. Fortunately for me, I didn't listen, and it'd be a shame for anybody else. Yeah. It'd be a shame to see that happen, as it has with some of the people that you mentioned earlier. And on that note, part of the official part, I really want to thank you on behalf, not of the city, because I'll be honest with you, this is not run by the city of Hamilton. In fact, there was very little appetite to have this conversation. And I'll say it, I'll be very frank, which is why I kind of took it upon myself. And if I look around the room, I can see the dozens of community organizers that I know, probably going to go on a limb and say 123 Hamilton was probably registered today while this was on. If I know, no? Okay. And in that space, I wanted to just leave you with some Hamiltonia. Some wonderful gifts here that we might recognize. This is an official Jelly Brothers print of City Hall. This is a Jelly Brothers print. So okay. The Jelly Brothers are artisan activists, one of which is here this evening, Dan Jelly and his brother Matt. So they do this incredible artwork. And so on behalf of the activist community, we'll say the activists, they also make pillows. So you guys have a different experience. We want to present you with that, and with Frank O'Fett just passing on and celebrating the diversity that is our city, we also have this other gift here, which is from O's Clothes. It's a Jem Hamilton shirt that we want you to wear proud in Toronto.
Right now.
Yeah, awesome. Sweet.
Is it blue?
It's blue. Yeah. And so I just want to thank you, brother. I really appreciate it. Thank you. I also believe that given, yeah, there it is. I also believe that given the kind of official close of this, it's important and incumbent on me to recognize some of the folks that are here. Dave, you'll be happy to know that the organizing popular movement is alive and well here in Hamilton. We have Mr. Norman Kearney from the People's Platform, who just recently presented on something that's very similar in terms of participatory democracy. So I'd like to recognize Norman Kearney from the People's Platform. I'd like to recognize the incredible work of the Hamilton Civic League. They've been in it for a long haul here. We have Larry Pomerantz and his crew. Larry's up here with the Hamilton Civic League. I'd also like to recognize Hamilton for Transit, Lindsay Goddard, who met you on the way in, took your information on the lists. There is a group of people in this city that are growing around our transit issues. As you know, we're transforming through the recent announcement of LRT, as well as the major shift at council towards conventional transit, which is very exciting. And so there's going to be some organizing around that as well. I'd like to recognize Wilhelmina McGurman, who from the First Nations community is like an auntie to me and an elder. And early in my candidacy, I had the conversation with Wilhelmina, and she shared her story with me, which was about being visible for the First Nations and for really for all minority communities, to let them know that it is possible to run in elections. She has run in multiple elections going back probably over the last 10 or 15 years, right? And so I think it's very important to note the work that you've done on this regard, Wilhelmina. I really appreciate all of that. also like to recognize Mr. Fife from the Hamilton District Labor Council, who's here this evening. They play a big role in terms of organizing around social justice issues. Most recently, they're taking on the living wage, which at a municipal level for us in Hamilton is really going to be integral to tackling some of the poverty reduction. Now, on the political side, yeah, please, give them a round. On the political side, being a nonpartisan person myself, I would like to recognize those that are politically involved in party organizing here. We have Peter Orman from the Green Party of Canada. We have my very good friend and brother Raheem Aman, who is now a nominated candidate candidate for nomination of the Green Party on the Hamilton Mountain. So we have Raheem. I'd also like to acknowledge Jonathan Rosenzan, who is a PC candidate for Hamilton Centre. They are here, and I appreciate your attending. And so the efforts that we're trying to pull together here in these forums, we'll be having Fair Vote come. We're very fortunate. In fact, I was on the phone today with Desmond Cole. He has, a great story and a great ability to provide a compelling reason why permanent residents really ought to be valued more in our communities and in our cities and municipalities. You know, to think that somehow it erodes the Canadian citizenship is absurd at the municipal level. These are people who have come over the generations, and as I understand the past, have also had the right in certain other points of our Canadian history to vote. And so I think that conversation is well worth having. I'm hopeful that prior to the 27th, the close of this commenting period, that Desmond will be here. We also have Professor Byrd, who is a local political science professor, who will be talking about increasing more women and having gender equality. I'd like to recognize Denise Christofferson, who also hosts what was it called? I apologize. I did attend as a male ally, but simple enough, elect more women. So give it up. And Denise, will that be held again this year? Perfect. And I'm happy to forward that on to the list that we're creating. The list that I am creating will be used. You know, like you said, there's no passengers on this bus. It will take and it will require you to go home tonight after thoughtful consideration. And if you believe in what was said today, if you believe that there is an alternative to our failing and broken democracy, that I encourage you not to wait until the 26th or 27th. Just go ahead and go home right now. It's posted on my website. You'll be able to find the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and the Honorable Ted McMeekin and make your comments heard. Go on the record, participate in this section of the democracy. It is historic. We are in a historic time with an opportunity to do something that has never been done and from a trajectory standpoint could really change the landscape of our Canadian democracy. So with that, I would certainly like to once again give my warm thanks and gratitude to everybody that is present today. These events don't just happen. I'd like to thank Joey Coleman for recording this and putting it on the public record. I'd like to also announce that Joey will be doing a crowdfunding campaign tomorrow. And I would encourage you to try to beat me tomorrow to donate to his campaign. I'll be doing that first in the morning. And if you can beat me, there'll be a little prize in it for you. And I say that because his efforts don't come for free, and his work is extremely valuable in archiving what happens here in the city. In archiving it, putting it on the public record, I know we've all used it as organizers and activists to refer back to what was actually said in full context. Outside of mainstream media and everything else, what was actually said in full context, you can go to the public record and you'll have a chance tomorrow to donate. So I would highly encourage you to do that. The last person I'd like to thank really is my executive assistant, Simon Granite, who really is integral in all of this. And I would also like to welcome Annette to my team, who is going to be helping me over the course of Pan Am. So, I'm hopeful that I could probably name each one of you and thank you all. I know you very well. But I'm hopeful I've covered my political bases. I'd like to thank Mr. Nolan for showing up and Mr. Kevin Werner for showing up from the media, and certainly look forward to this conversation. Do we have a poll right now on the best pizza, local pizza? Do we know where that is? Because it's in the rider. Oh, you're high. That's high class right there. They got tablecloths. Only the best. Well, only the best for you. I suppose we could go crash the Capri. That wouldn't be a problem. So we will convene over here. We'll go down the Capri, and we'll have some of our city's best pizza. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so very much. I hope you didn't get a parking ticket. And if you did, you can send it to Dan Nolan. No, I'm kidding.